All right, good morning, everyone. It's 8:30. We'll call this morning's meeting to order. Our first item is the approval of the agenda.
So moved.
We have a motion to approve and a second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried.
We'll move on to employee recognitions. Our first one this morning is Matthew Sevesco. And he's not going to be here, right? But you're going to come up, Georgia, and just he's Matthew has had 15 years of dedicated service, so you make sure you tell him.
Yep. Thank you.
Do you want to say anything about?
Well, Matt's been with us for 15 years, and he's pretty much led the training up part also the custodial staff with our changes, and he's been a leader, and it's really been greatly appreciated.
All right. Next, we have Catherine Krogstad. I understand she's not going to be here, but we've got Kathy McKay. And Catherine also had 15 years, so you make sure you tell her thank you for her dedicated service. But you want to say anything?
Kathy has been, she's done some school nursing out in Holly and Spring Prairie, and she works with the waiver programs in our adult senior population. So she's been an asset to our Department of Nurses. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy.
Next, we have Catherine Endring, and I understand she is here. Yeah, here's Catherine. And Larry Young is going to come up.
Catherine also has 15 years of outstanding and dedicated service to the county. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you, Catherine, for your 15 years at Clay County. She has worked with the family programs that we have, the MFIP and DWP program. A few years ago, we had a lot of staff turnover, and it was in the family team, so we had a lot of new staff, and Kathy's been very valuable about training the new staff to understand the programs. So she's doing a great job.
All right. And the next one is Denise Thinke, and she has 25 years.
And she's not here today either.
All right. Well, Rhonda, you're going to take care of that for us. You do that, and you make sure you tell her congratulations and thank you for her dedicated service.
I'll do that. Okay, so Denise has been with the county since 1992. She actually started out in the auditor's office, and then 7 years later moved over to our child support unit. She's a support enforcement aide, and she does, her primary responsibility is income withholding for folks that have child support payments. So she does an amazing job, and we just appreciate all she does.
And last but not least, we have Bruce Jaster. 30 years, Bruce. My goodness.
Time flies when you're having fun. Tim, you're going to come up. I've known Bruce for a long time. Back before I was on the county board, I was on the Oakport Town Board. And Bruce will remember those days. They were somewhat, a lot of turmoil up there because of the sewer issues that were going on up there. And there was 50% of the people thought we needed new sewers and 50% didn't. And Bruce really helped guide through that process. I remember that quite well. So
yeah, that was fun days.
Yeah. We'll keep that plaque and congratulations.
You bet. Thank you.
Tim, you want to?
Well, I hardly remember a day here at Clay County without Bruce being in it. I've been here just a little bit longer than he has, and it's a good thing. And I was going to mention the Oakport thing. He's been here long enough to remember that, how much fun it actually was. When it finally got done, it was a good thing, but it took a lot of work. And you know, Bruce has been our number one sewer guy for a long time. and he does food and beverage and lodging inspections too.
That's a sideways comment.
Think about that. But he's been very good to work with. He's an excellent employee, and I do appreciate his time here.
Okay, our next item is citizens to be heard. Do we have any citizens to be heard from anybody who's not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move on to the approval of the bills and vouchers.
So move.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carries. We have minutes from March 14th and the 21st.
Move to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Discussion? Seeing none. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Our 835 item is a resolution authorizing application for funds for family homeless prevention and assistance projects. We have Becky Johnson from Prairie Lakes.
Lakes and Prairies.
Lakes and Prairies, excuse me, Community Action Partnership. Good morning, Becky.
Good morning. We put together some statistics on our program as well. Lakes and Prairies has a variety of housing programs ranging from some short-term crisis assistance that helps people get out of homelessness quickly and get stabilized in housing, all the way up to permanent supportive housing that works with people who are chronically homeless who need some long-term supports that are going to not be able to be successful in housing without some case management and some follow-along support from case managers. The program that we're asking for a resolution of support today from the Commission is called Family Homeless Prevention and Assistance Program. This is a program that we've held for over 15 years. We have to renew our request for funding every 2 years. So this program is a program that helps people prevent from entering into homelessness or exit homelessness quickly. We have a screening tool that assesses the people with the highest amount of need, and that's how we select the households that we are able to assist out of the higher number that apply. In the last biennium, we had, since we started this biennium in July 1st of 2015, we have assisted 211 households with this program. Equating to 570 individuals. But with assisting those 211 households, we had almost 550 households apply. So it's the funds are very needed. They don't stretch far enough, but they do a lot for what we're able to work with. We do provide case management along with that. So when we're helping people financially, we're also providing assistance with communicating with their landlord, helping them locate an apartment that is safe and affordable for them. We're doing budgeting with them. We offer a financial literacy class that helps them understand budgeting, the importance of savings, how to understand a credit report, all of those types of consumer protection issues. That is all part of this program as well. The new biennium that we're requesting funds for, we're asking for a significant increase to add some staff positions both in Clay and in Wilkin County to cover our full service area. This will include services for homeless individuals primarily. With the homeless folks in town here, we do a coordinated entry system now in this area where we do an assessment and everybody goes on to a coordinated prioritization list. So all of the homeless programs are pulling from the same list and people only need to get assessed and do one application essentially. When we know on that application we have over 400 individuals waiting for the rapid rehousing level of intervention assistance. So that is a medium length, up to 24 months of assistance. So a time-limited program that helps them locate housing, get stabilized in the housing, help them work on their employment and education goals, help them get their budget really squared away before we exit them off the program. So this increase in funding that we're requesting would add an additional staff position that could work with 12 households at a time on that type of program as well.
A question.
Commissioner Mitchell.
Am I reading this right? 99% of the households that you served were stable at exit?
Yes, we've changed the way that we work with households now. So rather than providing one-time assistance and saying that was it, you had your 1 month, you're on your own, we're keeping them on until we've really made sure that they are stabilized. So if they have an underlying mental health issue, we're getting them connected to mental health services and making sure that they are stable before we exit them. So rather than 1 month of assistance, that means we may be providing 3-4 months worth of assistance, but it really increases our numbers in terms of the outcomes that we're seeing when they exit our program.
Great.
When you talk about 400 households, is this just Clay County or is this the Mason area? I mean, does this cover more than one county? Or just, are there 400 just in Clay County?
Clay and Wilkin.
Clay and Wilkin?
Yeah, Wilkin represents a fairly small number of households. I believe so far this year we have served 27 households in Wilkin County out of the 211 that we serve total. So it's Clay County definitely makes up the bulk of the need. This is where the homeless shelters are for our area, for our service area, and in Wilkin County we tend to see the households that we serve there are prevention households, not homeless households. So the rapid rehousing additional staff person that I mentioned, that would be a Clay County position as well.
Do you partner at all with the Clay County HRA in any way?
We do. We work very closely with the HRA. They're also involved in that coordinated entry process that I mentioned with pulling households off of that. We also work with them. They have the HRA Cares for Kids program for the highly mobile students, and we have used these family homeless prevention dollars to provide case management for some of those households that needed just a little extra support along with the rental assistance that they receive from the HRA. And we do that with some of our other programs as well, provide the case management piece to their rental assistance piece so that we can pool our funds and resources together to give comprehensive services.
So basically this application goes to the Minnesota Housing Finance Agency, right?
Correct.
And is that also federal funds that is administered by the state, or is this all state
this
funds?
This is all state funds for this.
Okay.
One.
Mm-hmm. And do they have a set allotment per year that they have to deal with? I'm assuming they do.
They do, yeah.
Okay.
They have a set allotment, and then they also break it out by metro and greater Minnesota, so
okay.
We're not competing against the need that they have in the metro. So we know that I believe there's about $17 million for greater Minnesota.
So do they have some sort of a formula for rural Minnesota then, where each county you kind of have an idea what you can receive from them? Or?
It's grant-based.
It's all grant-based.
It is, yes. Needs, so they do have a scoring method that is based on past performance, which we score very highly in every biennium. And then also they look at the need, so they look at census numbers and the Wilder count numbers and the point in time count that our continuum of care does every year, and they determine what level of need we have. So they kind of combine all of that information along with the strength of the grant application and decide our funding level from there.
Any other questions?
I'm making a motion to support resolution 2017-15.
All right, we have a motion to approve the resolution. Do we have a second?
I'll second the motion.
Okay. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion on the motion? Seeing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried.
Before Becky leaves, I do want to say Becky and several other members of staff at Lakes and Prairies completed a very vigorous coursework last year, and from what I'm told, it's quite an honor to have at least one person with that certification, and now we have how many in the office over there?
We have four now, and we have three more testing this
right.
year.
So they're doing good work. Part of this is reflective of your phenomenal grant writing ability, Becky, so thanks a lot for what you do over there.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Becky. Okay, and next up we have a proclamation in support of Child Abuse Prevention Month. We have Amy Amundson and Stacy and Rhonda.
She was not able to join us,
okay.
So I'm going to sit up with Stacy.
With Stacy and Rhonda.
Yeah.
Good morning.
So April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, so we're here to do a proclamation and share with you a little bit about what our Child Abuse Prevention Council is doing for the month of April.
So the Child Abuse Prevention Council is called CAPSI, and with that we have a small budget line where we have some dollars available to help us bring awareness to the community and celebrate April as Child Abuse Prevention Month. We've obtained a billboard through the Newman Signs in which it identifies April as Child Abuse Prevention Month. It has a pinwheel, which is the symbol for prevention on there, as well as the phone number for our child intake line. We'll be putting signs throughout the Family Service Building identifying 10 reasons to stand up for children, as well as listing the phone number for our child intake line. This Thursday, we have our community child protection team meeting. At that time, whatever team members are available, we'll be putting pinwheels throughout the county campus, as well as blue ribbons around the trees. And then several of our schools have agreed to put some posters up in their buildings, just to, again, further bring awareness in the community.
Yeah, and Stacy, do you want to talk about who's represented on the CAPSI team?
Well, our CAPSI team has kind of fluctuated at different times. We've had some broad representation. At this time, it's really myself, Amy, Terry Bush from Public Health has had a strong presence. Carolyn Sternett at times has had a presence with us, several of the school's social workers. And then we actually had a few interns from Lakes and Prairies, and the detention center expressed an interest in participating. Mm-hmm.
And law enforcement is involved as well. So in addition to what the CAPSI team does, our agency is involved with other multiple efforts aimed at addressing issues that families face that contribute to child abuse and neglect. So we're working with a campaign that involves the Fargo-Moorhead area on ending child sexual abuse. So we're actually going to be this summer really working on a curriculum to educate folks in the community about how to recognize sexual abuse signs, how to report, that kind of thing. We also work with the Children's Action Network, again, which is kind of a Cass Clay initiative aimed at addressing, again, the factors that we see that contribute to child abuse and neglect. So there are a multitude of things going on, but April is an opportunity for us to kind of do a little bit more of a splash and awareness for our community. And we don't often get to bring things for you, but these are the pinwheels that you'll see, and we're going to leave these with you. Blue is the color for child abuse prevention, so pinwheel for prevention. And Stacy talked about the ribbons that go around, so you'll each have one of these, and maybe you can tie a tree at your somewhere with those, representing that. And we have stickers and pencils, and these are just kind of some of the things that that you'll see the month of April, the blue ribbon, again, just symbols and a recognition on the prevention of child abuse. So we're gonna leave these with you. Yeah, you're welcome. And then we do have the proclamation.
All right, would you like me to read that?
Sure.
All right. Okay, Child Abuse Prevention Proclamation. Whereas our children are our most valuable resource and will shape the future of Minnesota and Clay County. Whereas in the year 2016, Clay County Social Services completed 457 assessments and investigations of families in licensed facilities, assessed 839 children for alleged child abuse or neglect, provided 380 families with child protection case management, and 190 families with child welfare case management, and provided care and services for 292 children in and out of home placement. Whereas child abuse is a serious problem affecting every segment of our community and can have a long-term psychological, emotional, and physical effect that may cause lifelong consequences for victims of abuse. Whereas effective child abuse prevention succeeds because of meaningful and trusting partnerships created between parents, practitioners, schools, faith communities, health organizations, law enforcement agencies, and the business community. Whereas family-serving, youth-focused prevention programs offer positive alternatives for young people, encourage parents and youth to develop strong ties to their communities, as well as provide protective factors that reduce or eliminate risk by promoting social, emotional, and developmental well-being of children. Whereas we acknowledge we must work together as a community to increase awareness about child abuse and contribute to the promotion of children and families' social and emotional well-being and safe, stable, nurturing environments. Whereas prevention remains the best defense for our children and families. Now, therefore, be it resolved that Clay County Board of Commissioners hereby proclaim April 2017 as Child Abuse Prevention Month in Clay County and call upon all citizens, community agencies, religious organizations, medical facilities, and businesses to increase their participation in efforts to prevent child abuse and neglect, thereby strengthening the communities in which we live.
Thank you.
All right. Do we have a motion on that?
So moved.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any further discussion?
Well, I think, you know, just looking at that second paragraph, the number of children, 839 children assessed for child abuse or neglect. That's amazing. And it's not amazing. That's not the right word for that. That's quite a figure.
Yes.
How long are these children normally in our services? Is there a length, or isn't there no average that really you come up with that?
When we conduct the assessments, that 800 number, those are completed within 45 days. The children that receive the case management services, I would say, can be anywhere from 3 months to 12 months. Those are families that we've identified are at high risk for their children to experience future maltreatment or abuse. So that's the purpose of that work, is to prevent further concerns for the children. As far as the out-of-home placements go, the average can be anywhere from 3 months to 15 months, or perhaps permanency, in which the children the parents have their parental rights terminated and the children are placed for adoption.
All right,
all in favor of the motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you.
All right, next we have a resolution to support the Buffalo watershed and implementing one watershed, one plan. Looks like Bruce isn't here, but we have two of the board members here.
Bob, the underling, Jim. Good morning.
Good morning.
I have some propaganda to send around first.
These are already put in the tubes, so just take one.
We're here to request a resolution of support for the One Watershed, One Plan that we would like to undertake. It depends upon, first of all, getting a grant from the Board of Water and Soil Resources, and that's a process that you go through to apply. The application is due by April 18th, I believe it is, this month. And in order to do that, we really have to have the support of all the counties that are in the watershed. So that includes Clay and Wilkin and Becker and Otter Tail. This program, One Watershed, One Plan, has been around for a while. The idea, anyway, started back in 2012 when the legislation was passed. It actually came from the roundtable, local government water roundtable, that included the counties, the soil and water conservation districts, and the watershed districts. The idea of that, to have one comprehensive plan on a watershed scale. And in our case, in the Buffalo Red River Watershed District, it includes those four counties. I know that some counties that look at this and they say, wow, you know, we have a lot of plans. They maybe have several watersheds in their county. I think Clay County is maybe a little more lucky in this respect because you're pretty much covered by the Buffalo Red and Wild Rice. So you have a couple watersheds, not five or six or something of that nature. So that's what we're about. The plan would be, in fact, there's going to be a meeting this afternoon of people from all of the different counties to talk about this and lay some plans. But if we have the resolutions from all of the counties then and the support of all the counties, then the application would go to Board of Water and Soil Resources, or at least the application for the grant. And if we get the grant, then we'd probably be working on this for about 2 years to put the plan together.
And the plan's ultimate goal is what?
The plan's ultimate goal is to have one plan then for that watershed area that, is, as I say, a comprehensive plan. We refer to it as a targeted, measurable, and plan that where we identify, you know, all of those problem areas, I guess, that we have in the county or counties in that watershed district, and we have a plan for solving those. Okay. We lay that out.
So this doesn't eliminate the. The work within an individual watershed where it's the watershed's authority to implement projects, that we're not turning that over to anybody else.
No. In fact, and the idea would be in this one, this one plan that covers the entire area, it would be to incorporate all of Clay County's points of their plan that they have now in that plan, as well as the other counties.
Does it change the approval process? I mean, of a project from being able to be permitted and implemented?
No. Nothing has changed in that way.
Okay.
I have one question. This last line of this resolution, it says, pending selection as a recipient of a planning grant. What? Who's going to be the recipient of this planning grant? I don't know if you're acquainted with it or not, but I was just looking at this. Last line, it says pending selection as a recipient.
Okay, the recipient would be the watershed district. We make application to the Board of Water and Soil Resources for that grant that covers the supposedly the cost of the development of the plan is what it's about.
Jay, did you have anything you want to add to?
I'll make a motion for the support of this resolution.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, the same.
We thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Now the work begins. If we can get the money, then we'll start to work on it. Right now we've got a comprehensive plan that we are working on that was just to include this new area, the watershed district, and that hasn't been concluded yet. So if this comes through and if we were selected, we would just immediately shift to the one watershed, one plan. We wouldn't go and put it on that one at that point.
Have you guys had any conversations with the Wild Rice watershed? Are they looking at a similar grant for their
I don't know where they are at in this. Bowser has a sort of a plan for the rollout of one watershed, one plan. It is kind of so many counties so many watersheds every year. If you look in the back of one of those handouts, it has the watersheds actually mapped. And you can see, it's, in the case of Red Lake was one of the pilot watershed districts. We had four pilot watersheds in Minnesota. Red Lake was one of these, and I think they have about eight counties involved. So they have quite a large number.
I think this is something that Isn't this something that Moore Landing had worked on for a long time, or is that a different one watershed?
He may have had some involvement with him when he was in as representative, but I, but not directly that I know of. Round table was the one that came up with the idea, and they brought it to Water Water Soil Resources, and they took it to legislation. The legislation was passed in 2012 to go on with this. So.
Very good. Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Jerry. Now,
is Booz around as well?
Yes, he is.
Oh,
I got a question.
All right, Dave. Good morning, Dave.
Good morning.
You're here today on a approval of final contract voucher for County State Highway 18 and County State Highway 11.
Yeah, we finally got approval and agreement on the final vouchers with central specialties on these two. And I think everything came together really well as far as our final. They wanted some additional funds for some topsoil work that we had done, and there was a little some miscommunications and some things there. They did a lot of extra work. It did take them a lot of extra time. There was some wet material out there that we had used in the previous year that we absolutely had to get moved off the site. So. I think it worked out for both parties. Both contracts did underrun a little bit. We had a lot of extra gravel in place from the previous contract that we didn't need on the paving project that we're approving today. So County Road 18, the original contract was just a little over $3.4 million. The final amount to be approved is $3,205,255.68, so a little over $200,000 under running on gravel on that one. This project was also tied with that the north approach panel on the County Road 11 bridge. There was a big drop off there. We removed that, put some foam in there, and repaved the concrete on top. That original contract was a little over $269,000. Final amount to be approved is $263,735.18. Like I said, the contractor was Central Specialties out of Alexandria. Central did sub out quite a bit of the work on that approach panel. PCI did all the concrete paving on it. Turned out really well. It rides really nice. Kind of very happy with it.
Questions?
I'll make a motion to approve the final contract.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried. Thank you, Dave.
Thanks.
I have a question for you. I've been getting some calls about 52.
Yeah.
It's heaving really bad.
We were out there with some signs and some cones, and I talked to our guys a little yesterday. You know, there must be some water in there, some frost coming out of the ground. I don't know. We're going to have to kind of see what we can do out there. Those are a little tricky this time of year. I'm not really sure. I'm real happy with how they got signed right now. They got stuff out in the road, but it is kind of hard. The heaving, there's several blisters that have shown up. I think they're about the size of a manhole. And they've went up 6-8, maybe more inches, I guess. I didn't get a chance to get down there, but.
I mean, they're big.
Yeah, and I think there's like maybe half a dozen of them or so.
Yeah, and I think like three more popped up yesterday.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. Hopefully those things go down. I guess our guys did go out to drill. They thought maybe if they could try to drill a little bit and relieve some of it. I think the water is underneath the old concrete panels. It's quite a bit deeper than just the first 12 inches or so. Maybe we can get a geotech guy to take a look at it with us or something.
Yeah, it's unfortunate because they just redid all.
Yeah, oh, for sure. Yeah. Normally, if you put a new culvert in or something, you'll get like an entire culvert heaving over, but these are just little blisters the size of a manhole, which is really weird. I don't think I've ever seen anything like this. Gravel roads, we see them all the time. You know, little. Obviously, there's water trying to get its way to the top there somehow, I guess. So we'll keep signing it appropriately, and hopefully we don't have any issues out there.
Where are they located?
Just out of Barnesville on 52.
Yeah, yep, somewhere between Barnesville and Baker there. The first mile and a half or so, we did a complete regrade a couple years ago. And then the next 2 miles, we just did a bituminous overlay. So the existing panels, concrete panels, are still there from the 30s. And then north of that, from Baker all the way to Sabin, we did a concrete overlay on that. So we, you know, that's more rigid paving, so we haven't seen any of these show up there. But it's a tough deal.
Well, let's just make sure we get them all signed. Because,
yeah,
I mean, they're big enough that,
sure.
you
you hit them hard fast enough, that's
dangerous. Yep, for sure.
Dave, I had sent you an email yesterday regarding a concern from citizens on Highway 3.
Correct.
For the board that's goes from Wall Street up to 18 here, which is the beet plant entrance. And in the past, we've never allowed semis to use that road. And apparently now that's being done.
Sounds like there's a lot of different users as part of the products coming in and coming out of the beet plant by the email chain that I read there as well. I know in the past we always worked with American Crystal, Trans Systems, and then the one of the suppliers that moves the sugar at Riley's Transport, and we were able to route them outside of
18,
yeah, get them on the trunk highway system and then come in on our County Road 18. It did sound like there was all kinds of other users that are on there.
What can we do about that? Because that's a heavy residential area,
sure,
with a lot of pedestrian traffic, and it's not a place for semis.
I was going to start with the city of Moorhead, being that that's all been annexed in there now, and see if maybe we can put a designated truck route, some signs up on County Road 18 going to the east there, and then maybe a no trucks sign up on our road in County Road 3, and see if that's something consistent with what they would like to see and what how they would handle it.
Because something's changed.
Are they trans system trucks? What are
no.
They?
Huh?
The trans system?
No.
Are they crystal trucks?
No. I think it's more, it's people hauling sludge. Oh, there's about five or six different users, it sounded like, of different byproducts of the process that are using
it. But it's trucks generated from American Crystal.
Correct. Related from American Crystal. So we might get them guys in the loop, too, to help us identify who they all are and get the word out that they need to, take the extra, it's only an extra mile, each way. It's like 2.1 miles of additional, so it really isn't that big of a deal. But I should be able to work with the city of Moorhead.
You can keep me posted on that.
Sure.
Let the board know, too. I don't know if any of you have been getting calls on it, but there's quite concern up there by residents on that.
Yeah.
So. All right. Thank you, Dave. Our next item is the approval of the purchase agreement for stormwater mitigation credit, and this has to do with our construction projects going on here at the county. Mr. Berg, do you want to start off?
Well, yes, Mr. Chair and members of the commission. I just wanted to mention that just what you did. This is part of our construction project, and with the parking lots and things going in, we needed a stormwater retention pond. The city is willing to work with us on it. We've talked about this before, that now they've gone ahead and bid the project down in the southern part of Moorhead, and it came in better than what we thought. The price is $122,000 and some change, and we were projecting maybe $175,000 to $200,000, somewhere in that area. So this is good news, and I guess I just wanted to remind you that this was part of our construction project up there that we've asked Mike Love to work on and coordinate with the city. So I guess he's just about got it all handed out here, and we can turn it over to him for the technical explanation of what they've done. So he's done a lot of work on it.
Thank you, Brian. I kind of put together a handout here to help kind of summarize what's going on. There's, like Brian had mentioned, there's the jail law enforcement center project needed some stormwater mitigation, so we've been working with the city of Moorhead on a project that they were actually looking at doing to kind of combine the two. That's the Belsley Swale Stormwater Mitigation Project, which is what I handed out to you. I just put two pages from the plan set in here. Basically, there was a dry retention pond off of Highway 75 there in 37th Avenue, and what we did was we actually dug the bottom out about 6 feet. We're planning to dig the bottom out 6 feet and turn that into a wet pond. So what that does is it allows the stormwater as it comes into the system to settle out the pollutants, and then by doing that you get credit for treatment, and then we'll take those credits and then apply them to the county. Like Brian mentioned, the construction project came in quite a bit
quite a bit under what we had estimated. Our engineer's estimate was $430,561.50. The low bid was Kindred Plumbing and Heating at $294,838.70. So with all the construction, engineering, administration, testing, all the fees added onto it, that brought the total, brings the total projected project cost to $419,507.10. So that number was used to determine what the credit purchase price would be. So if we go down the second kind of bolded area there where it talks about the stormwater mitigation credit purchase agreement, which is what Brian had brought up. So per that agreement, this Belsley project will create 10.1 credits, where a credit is equal to 1 pound of phosphorus removal per year. If you care, the equation for how we came up with the value of the credits on there, basically the jail and law enforcement center project requires 3.1 credits. And so then the purchase price for those 3.1 credits is $122,686, which I think our original estimates were in that 160 to 200 range. So came in quite a bit lower than what we were thinking. One other thing I wanted to mention on the back side of this, as part of the project, we have some excess dirt that we needed to get rid of from the Belsley project. And since we're also working, you know, with the county on the solid waste transfer facility, there's a need for dirt there. We actually coupled the two projects, and we're going to take our excess dirt from the Belsley project, bring it up and stockpile it on the solid waste transfer facility site. So it'll be cost savings for both projects. So. Yeah. I wanted to kind of bring that to the board's attention. So,
how much excess are you projecting?
Excess from here, I believe it's like 9,000 worth of good clay. There's more material to come out here. There's
tons or dollars.
9,000 yards. There's topsoil and silt and stuff that'll have to get disposed of elsewhere. But good clay, there's about 9,000 yards.
Isn't that where the solar panels are located
now? They're further north, actually. Yeah, they're just off the top of the page there, so.
Yeah, the land is south of the solar panels.
You can see the windmills.
And it's kind of right along 15th and 34th.
Okay. So there's two things kind of before you. I kind of just tried to list them on the very bottom there. So one, there's the mitigation credit purchase agreement that Brian had mentioned. And the other is when we originally kind of came to you with the concept of this project, we said that the city would go out for bids, get bids, but before they awarded it, they would ask for your approval to move forward with that. So there's two suggested approvals on the bottom of my page there. So
Mike, to make this work, that was what required that digging out and cleaning it out to allow for future settlement.
Correct.
How about, you know, because we're 3.1 or whatever you said our credits were of the 10.1 total,
yep,
credits. How about, is there anything that we have to deal with in the future with maintenance then, or is that?
Nope, that's all the administrative fee. There's fees and stuff that were added on top of the construction. The city has accounted for that in those fees. So
Okay. You
would not be responsible for any future maintenance on the pond.
Okay.
Good.
I
have one
question.
Just if you enlighten me a little bit of what's really happening here. I mean, we had a correction facility and a law enforcement center there before here, and we're going to have that again. So why do we need all this these extra credits on us? I mean, what are we doing that we need these extra credits for? I realize we're building it.
No, that's a good question. There's really the bulk of it is because you took those two blocks to the north that were primarily residential. So they had a lot more green space to them. And you're building, we built a big parking lot on there that has a lot of new impervious surface, and then with the law enforcement center with the parking lot is an increase in impervious area. So that increase in impervious area, so buildings and parking lots and stuff like that, allows additional pollutants to discharge from the site, and that's what you're mitigating for, those additional pollutants.
And there's no way that it really even settles in. Runs.
I guess I had my mind on the jail back here. I wasn't.
Yeah. It's really those two residential blocks is what kind of triggered it.
Okay. Thank you.
And Mr. Chair, another positive thing that Bob Zimmerman talked about when he proposed this idea was the fact that this had caused some disturbance down in South Moorhead because it was retaining water and it was odor and different things, and this cleans up this too. So it's really kind of a win-win for the county and the city.
Yeah, it's really just a cattail slough right now. It was originally designed to be a dry grass area that they could mow and maintain. Well, over time, it just kind of became wet and unmaintainable. So now it's full of cattails, and then when the cattails die and decay, it actually creates an odor. So the residents around there complain. So this was, like Brian had mentioned, this is a very, very win-win project for everyone here. So.
So because there's a pipeline going through, or you're just going to pop culverts in between? Is that the
correct
thought process?
Yeah, so we'll leave that area humped up, and then there'll be culverts for the low flows, and then there's actually an overflow. So when a lot of water comes through, it'll overflow.
So will this new part be deeper than the Mallard Creek?
It'll be about the same. I'm not sure what the actual depth of the Mallard Creek one is, but it's either 4 to 5. So this will be 6 feet, so it'll be really close to the same.
Thank you.
Jenny, you reviewed the contract?
Yes, I did review it, yes.
All right, very good. So we actually have the numbers that we can put into this contract then, right? I
think. Yeah, and they are actually in there. So the $122,686 is in the contract.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm looking at the one that.
Oh, you were looking at
the copy that doesn't have numbers.
You have the copy one there.
All right. Well, it's nice to see those numbers come in lower than.
It's a good time to be bidding dirt projects. There's a lot of hungry dirt contractors out there. So,
okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the mitigation credit purchase agreement.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried.
And a second. I need a second motion for that.
Oh.
We got two of them here.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion for the second one.
Okay, we have a second?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same. Motion carried.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Say, Mike, I'm just wondering why you're here. I know you've been dealing an awful lot with the infrastructure stuff around here, and I know Brian was going to maybe comment a little bit to the board on an update from our meeting yesterday, but I raised a concern now that they're putting this fence up on 9th Street. Those fence posts go right up to the curb. And currently, there's no sidewalks on the other side of the street. And currently, they're allowing parking on the west side of 9th Street.
Okay.
And traditionally, there is an awful lot of pedestrian traffic. And I don't know, we've sent a message off to Bob Zimmerman regarding if there's a way we can have that same signed as a construction zone and lower speed limit.
Sure.
Every bit of help we can get to try to accomplish that, I think it would be beneficial.
Yeah, I wonder, I think Bob's out this week for diversion stuff, but I'll be meeting with Tom Trowbridge, assistant city engineer, this afternoon, so I can bring it up to him.
Would you do that today? That's a concern that
we could probably, have the police department sign that no parking or something too temporarily along that stretch or something.
I think we need to get it from both the north and the south. And it's kind of like you have a reduced speed in the school zone. A lot of construction zones have reduced speeds, and I just think it's good.
Well, and we might. I mean, if it's just a matter of posting a lower speed limit, we could probably have construction engineers add some more signs out there or something too. I mean, they can sign it at a lower speed for construction too. Okay. So, I mean, if that's something that we want to do, I'll talk to Tom.
Tom and see what. Sure. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Yep.
Joe. Good morning, Joe. We want to replace some carpet.
Yes, good morning. What I'm requesting today is to move forward with replacing the carpet in the attorney's office. This includes the whole office and all the small offices within the suite. So we've brought this to committee, and I think we've talked about decided that the attorneys were kind of the first one on the list when we start this carpet program that we do. I think we still have more to discuss as far as, you know, what we do next after this. So I guess I'm requesting to move forward with this. And what I have done is went out and got two quotes, one from Wyvoda. It's $19,740, and then a second one from the Carpet Garage at $27,878. And this includes tearing out and installing new carpet and new base. So the other thing is they're doing some moving around now with the new office addition and stuff, so timing-wise, too, kind of works out as far as doing this project. So and we would propose to take this out of Fund 13, which is currently we have $140,000 in there to support this project. So.
Right. Okay, yeah, we've discussed this, but this is just for the attorney's office. We're not moving ahead with anything else.
Right. Yeah, I plan to bring, working on a carpet plan, and we've discussed the whole courthouse as a whole and how we're going to stretch it over, you know, years, you know, and everything is going to go to the committee and decide.
Yeah, because some carpet doesn't need to be replaced yet. I don't feel everything needs to be replaced, but this is the attorney's office, and we discussed that at the committee, and I'll make a motion to approve to vote a carpet.
Good. Second.
You have a motion and a second. Discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, the same sign. Motion carried. Thank you, Joel.
Thank you.
All right. Committee reports. We'll go the opposite today. We'll start with Commissioner Haney.
I don't have anything to report since last week.
All right. Commissioner Gross?
Yeah, yesterday morning I television, Minnesota Rural Counties. There's quite a few things were discussed there, you know, like Enbridge is challenging some of the taxation on pipelines, and it's going to affect probably Minnesota too. They're looking at Minnesota's assessing pipelines a lot higher than some of the surrounding states, and they're challenging that we're assessing pipelines too high. So that's one of the things that's going on. Broadband bill is, they are looking at putting some money in the broadband bill, but it's a little bit lower than it was anticipated by the Minnesota Rural Counties, so we would like to see a little bit more in there. The buffers, they're looking at getting $10 million needed to administer the program. They're looking at taking some money out of the Clean Water Legacy Fund, about $2 million from there, and whether that'll go through or not, it's not, but we need some money. If we're going to administer these buffer zones, we're going to need some money to do that. Transportation, we're trying to move to get more dedicated funds, is what MRC is supporting. They think the gas tax is pretty much dead. They don't think that's going to pass at all. They're looking at working on tap fees probably. County Program 8, they're trying to get that form of change. All 87 counties in the state of Minnesota have voted to support the change formula, so they're trying to get the legislature to go along with that. And last night I attended the Hawley City Council meeting, and as some of these cities that have been attending, Hawley included, they're getting 16 more lots for expansion. They also got a business center downtown, and they got two new businesses going in there, so they're everything going good down in Hawley. From there, I went, let's see, what else in Hawley? From there, I went to Georgetown, and they're concerned about finishing up there. There's still some work to be done up there to finish up their dike project. So that's what I got to get together with Bruce Albright there and see what we can do to get that program done. Then I went to Felton City Council meeting. And then he commented on our small cities meetings that we're having. And I realized that we were small cities, but they still consider themselves a smaller city. You know, they feel they would like to see when we have those meetings that we have sort of a group gathering of small cities, you know, like when they consider like Felton, Georgetown, and some of those, hit it all. Could we get together, hire one maintenance person to do 2-3 cities? You know, because they can't hire a full-time maintenance person, but they need a maintenance person. So, I mean, they feel some of that discussion they didn't have. I mean, we talked, we had different people there from the county talking to these people, and they would like sort of like, not that they can't hold that themselves, but they thought that would have been a good addition, that if some of the smaller cities would have just got together and discussed some of those things. And I guess that was their thoughts on that meeting there. So, and as I was the other, when I was in Georgetown, I invited them to come to the small cities meeting. So hopefully, you know, I've been at Yulin and hit it all and invited all these people to come to those meetings. So probably if we get them all together, they could have a discussion point there. And those were my meetings.
And Commissioner Wayland is in the cities. He was there on county business and will be back in town tomorrow, I think.
Thank you. Last week I attended the Community Facilities Task Force. If you recall, that's a meeting with the City of Moorhead, Clay County, and the Moorhead School Districts. It's a meeting that we put together to help coordinate our larger projects to do that with sensitivity to how much we tax everyone. So we had a good update from Moorhead Schools on their building projects. They're pushing along. Their elementary school should be done by the end of July, and the middle school shortly thereafter. Talked a little bit about the juvenile detention space needs that we're experiencing. Also, in collaboration, the transfer station with the City of Moorhead. And I felt it continues to be a good conversation between our entities. I have the pictures of the schools if you wanted that. And Friday I attended the Buffalo Red River Watershed District Advisory meeting, where we talked a little bit about what they've been doing for the past year. We're well aware of that because we've been to many meetings with them. I do have a copy of their budgets. It's fascinating to see what each ditch system's financials are, so you're more than welcome to see that. And also talked about the general levies that they've, the history of that, only had about 1.5% increase over the last year. That concludes my reports.
All right. One additional thing. When I was at Holly, the school there is going to have a Holly Youth Prevention Partners, and they're going to bring a speaker in, Jeff Linkenbach, going to talk about underage drinking. And I don't think this is an area-wide. I think it's pretty much for Holly people, but I think it'd be interesting for other school systems to be looking at this for underage drinking, and it'd be a good session to go to. It's on April the 20th at the Holly Elementary Gym.
Thank you. Okay, I also had the Community Facilities Task Force meeting that Commissioner Mojo talked about. I don't really have anything to add to that. Yesterday we had the our semi-monthly meeting of the construction managers for the joint facilities that we're working on here. In that, we went over the current owner contingency change orders that are out there, and right now the ones that are being proposed would see a change order to the good for Clay County in the amount of $11,369. So you're actually saving some money this week in change orders, which is a good thing. There was a
One fairly significant change order on the contractor contingency, and that was for $9,000, and that had to deal with, there was some changes required in the specifications of the laundry equipment. So it required them to upgrade to a more expensive, equipment. Sounds like the cell construction and the exterior panels are all being worked on as we speak, so everything is moving along. It sounds like all the steel and all of those things are well going according to plan and timing, so that is good. So this next couple of weeks, it's pretty much going to be just demolition. Demolition of the parking lots, and I think by the end of today they said that fence should be up around the area there. So I did want to comment on the presentation that was given by the Clay County HRA last week, and I had asked the questions, and I think you might have all gotten this an email with a response from Executive Director Dara Lee regarding the amount of seniors who are cost burdened by their rent and what have you, and it's disappointing to see that there are 1,500 cost burdened senior households in our county. That's very disappointing, and 22% of those happen to be people who own property and are trying to figure out ways to keep them in their homes. So that's another challenge in itself. But I want to thank Dara for providing that to us. Mr. Berg, your report.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair. Sheriff's Department and myself met with the United States Marshal Service in a preliminary meeting in reference to space in the jail and what will be available and charges and things like that. So we're opening the door to that issue because we feel we will have some spare space in the jail when we do open the new jail. And we certainly want to maximize on that if we can. Had a couple meetings in regards to a couple of zoning cases. Some of you commissioners are aware of some of those that are affecting your district. Had one meeting on Wednesday, referenced the P3 reviews. And we had a meeting with Steve and Janelle, Steve Larson and Janelle Cheney with probation, referenced the restorative justice grant that has not been successful to gain. And we'll be bringing some more information forward on that, looking at some different options there. The community facility meeting has already been talked about. Had a personnel evaluation. Had a meeting Monday morning with Carson from Senator Franken's office. And he will be setting up a meeting with the staff of the Senator's staff, and just to kind of try to get input from you folks and our staff and the city in reference to the federal budget and how it's going to be affecting the area, you know, from the agricultural legislation. You know, when you think of the ag bill, you think of the farmers. Well, there's much, much more in the ag bill than just farmers and their safety net. It's the food stamp program is in there and some many other things. So it's a big effect to the community. Had our construction meeting yesterday morning. That's already been covered. And I got one note down here that I'm not following. Oh, had some personnel meetings in reference to some things got cleared up. We had a lawsuit against us that was dismissed and things like that. So covered some of that. One thing I did do, you had asked me to contact Wild Rice Watershed to talk about the buffer zone, and I did that. And I'll just read you Kevin's response. Kevin Rude, the administrator up there in Wild Rice Watershed, and I think Frank or Commissioner Gross, you've attended a meeting up there, but the board has, this is the Wild Rice Watershed Board has decided whether to be enforcing the entity or not, and they're waiting till the legislative session is over before they make a decision. And I suggested maybe to Kevin that he come down and give a update to the county board on the watershed's activity, and then we can discuss the buffer zone issue at that time a little bit more. And Commissioner Campbell had brought up yesterday that the construction company has asked about a groundbreaking ceremony for the projects that we're having that will be undertaken. And he wanted me to bring that up at this meeting to discuss with you folks a date and time, or if you want a groundbreaking ceremony for, they're starting to prepare the fencing, and they'll do the demolition and start on the jail. And we were wondering about maybe in early May, maybe a Tuesday, to have a groundbreaking ceremony and involve the city with that and the community. So what's your thoughts, folks?
Following our meeting?
Yeah, probably.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was kind of hoping we could just wait and have it sometime after we have the gross maximum price come in on the LEC, so that part's done, and we could probably just do it right out here on the corner of, away from all the stuff that's going on inside. But is there a preference on the date by any of you?
First part of May, first or second Tuesday in May then?
Mm-hmm.
On a date that's not raining.
Okay, we will.
Yeah, watch the forecast, and then it's a matter of who we should invite. I certainly think we should put an invitation out to all those people that served on our committee that helped with that process.
Right.
I suppose the city council should be invited. The Warren City Council is a partner in the LEC. Anybody else you can think of, just let Brian know.
Yeah, please do. And first or second, maybe the second Tuesday in May. I don't know why I'm thinking that.
Why don't you just, whatever you think works best for everybody's schedule.
Very good. And then just a reminder that we have that meeting after this meeting today.
At
10 o'clock.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
That'll run till what time?
About 2:30, somewhere in that area.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That's concludes my report.
Clean, you got any?
One
more item.
Okay,
right. Senator Eakin and Representative Marker, they're going to be holding some town hall meetings next Monday, April the 10th. They're going to be at Hitterdahl at 12:30. They're going to be at Dilworth's City Hall at 2 o'clock, Barnesville at 4 o'clock, Hawley at 5:30. So if anybody in the area wants to attend some of those town hall meetings, I mean, those are the times I think they've been in the paper, or you can contact those cities when they'll be. But if you've got some concerns or something for the representative, senator, show up at the meeting.
Thank you.
We're adjourned.